The most successful theory in all of physics is arguably quantum field theory. It's made the most precise predictions in all of science, but it's also made the worst. There's a massive disagreement between the theoretical and the measured values of the energy of the vacuum. We call this theoretical fail the vacuum catastrophe. The quantum vacuum is a seething ocean of activity. Virtual particles appear and vanish from nowhere in seeming violation of our intuitions about the conservation of mass and energy. We saw in our recent episode that we can thank the Heisenberg uncertainty principle for this bizarre behavior. It tells us that there's a quantum fuzziness in the amount of energy contained at every point in space, a non-zero, zero-point energy in the quantum fields that can briefly manifest as particles. This suggests that space itself contains energy. But how much energy? Quantum field theory predicts that the energy of the vacuum should be up to 120 orders of magnitude greater than the measured value. It's one of the greatest unsolved problems in physics. Let's talk about vacuum energy from a theoretical standpoint. From the perspective of quantum field theory, every point in space is represented by a quantum oscillator, one for each elementary particle type. Higher energy oscillations represent the presence of real particles. However, even the lowest possible energy oscillation, the one corresponding to the absence of particles, the so-called vacuum state, has some energy. To satisfy the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, the vacuum state of any field oscillation must be half of the tiny Planck constant times the frequency of that oscillation. Now, that's a minuscule amount of energy. Except, to properly describe a perfect vacuum, every single possible frequency mode at every point in space must have that amount of energy. To calculate the density of energy of the vacuum, we should add this tiny energy over an infinite range of frequency modes for all fields. Now, multiply a finite energy density, no matter how small, by infinity, and you get infinite energy density. We'll get back to whether the idea of infinite vacuum energy is actually possible. It certainly sounds a bit excessive, so maybe we can avoid it. Let's think in terms of the electromagnetic field. What if there's a maximum possible frequency for virtual photons? Then our sum of frequency modes would be finite. Now, it sounds like a hack, and it sort of is, but we're getting desperate. And anyway, there's an almost sensible cutoff for photon frequency. It's where photon energy is equal to the Planck energy, or 10 to the power of 19 giga electron volts. This is where our understanding of physics breaks down. Until we develop a theory of quantum gravity, we can't say whether photons above this energy are possible. So, if we add up the vacuum energy, including virtual photons, all the way up to the Planck energy, we get a finite number. A very, very large finite number. The energy density would be 10 to the power of 112 ergs per centimeter cubed. This back of the envelope estimate was first made by John Wheeler and Richard Feynman, who noted that one teacup of space with this energy density would contain enough energy to boil all of the oceans on the planet. Yet, even if vacuum energy did have a value this high, in fact, even if it were infinite, we may not notice, at least according to quantum theory. In fact, in both quantum mechanics and classical mechanics, a particle's equations of motion depend only on changes in energy. The zero point of the energy scale is irrelevant. As long as the vacuum energy is the same everywhere, then it's inaccessible to us as an energy source. We're going to come back to that point in an upcoming episode, so you'll be able to knowledgeably scoff at zero-point energy perpetual motion machines. Long story short, a crazily high, even infinite vacuum energy doesn't affect the predictions of quantum field theory. Just redefine the zero point to whatever you want, and you're good to go. However, you can't be so cavalier with general relativity. Einstein's theory tells us that any form of energy produces gravity, and what matters is the absolute amount of energy, not relative deviations. Vacuum energy should produce a gravitational effect, and a huge vacuum energy should produce a huge gravitational effect. That effect would be seen in two ways. An energy of space itself should cause exponential expansion, at least in the case of an already expanding universe. It should also massively increase the spatial curvature of the universe. Now, this is all extremely unintuitive, and we spent 5 episodes trying to give you a sense of why this is true. Now, feel free to jump down that rabbit hole if you haven't already, but the upshot is that if vacuum energy really did have the enormous value predicted by theory, then our gently expanding, geometrically flat universe would not exist. The realization of this fact in the early days of quantum field theory was the beginning of what would become the vacuum catastrophe. But it wasn't a full-blown catastrophe yet. There was still a way out. If some fields can have extremely large positive zero-point energies, then perhaps others have extremely large negative zero-point energies that cancel them out. An extension to the standard model of particle physics called supersymmetry may partially allow this. It gives all particles a supersymmetric counterpart that may precisely cancel out their vacuum energy. Now, basic supersymmetry only allows us to cancel out photons down to the so-called electroweak energy, which brings the predicted vacuum energy down to a mere 10 to the 47 ergs per centimeter cubed. But perhaps a yet deeper theory allows perfect cancelling down to zero. For a while, theorists assumed that something like this must be happening, meaning the vacuum energy was really zero. It was a glimmer of hope that catastrophe could be averted. That is, until we discovered dark energy. In the late 90s, astronomers discovered that the expansion of the universe is, in fact, accelerating in exactly the way we would expect from a non-zero vacuum energy. Now, unlike the Lamb shift or the Casimir effect, the observation of accelerating expansion allows us to measure the absolute density of vacuum energy. Assuming vacuum energy is to blame, dark energy weighs in at 10 to the power of -8 ergs per centimeter cubed. Compare that to the number predicted by quantum field theory. There's a discrepancy of 120 orders of magnitude between the two, or 55 orders of magnitude if we use the electroweak energy cutoff instead of the Planck energy cutoff. Now that is what scientists call a catastrophe. QFT can give us an extremely high vacuum energy, or a vacuum energy of exactly zero if we assume symmetry of positive and negative zero points between different fields. But a very small non-zero vacuum energy? That requires what we call fine-tuning. Gigantic positive and gigantic negative zero-point energies would need to cancel each other out down to a very tiny non-zero value. That sounds like a ridiculously unlikely bit of luck if we can't invoke symmetries. A proposed solution is the anthropic one. We exist in an extremely rare universe whose fundamental fields cancelled out their zero-point energies, or at least enough of them to allow life and astronomers to evolve. That would imply countless other universes with different, less comfortable vacuum energies. Of course, it may be that advances in theory will resolve this catastrophe without requiring us to invoke the anthropic principle. In the meantime, the conundrum continues to perplex physicists and will do so until we reach a deeper understanding of the true nature of space-time. Last week we talked about the missing baryon problem and some new observations that have found this missing matter in the vast filaments of the cosmic web. You guys had a lot of great questions. Lucas Kukarski asked whether neutrinos belong to the dark sector or the light sector. Well, for a time it was thought that neutrinos might actually be dark matter, until it was realized they just don't contain enough mass, nor are they clumpy enough. They're too hot to pool into the deep dark matter wells that we see in galaxy clusters. At the same time, neutrinos don't interact electromagnetically, so they're in that sense dark. However, Usually the dark sector term is used to describe the actual sources of dark matter and dark energy. So in that sense, neutrinos aren't part of it. But these definitions are vague, so don't read too much into it. A few of you asked how matter becomes or remains so hot in these gigantic filaments of the cosmic web. Well, the key to this is that they're extremely low density. The average density in the filaments is maybe 20 baryons per cubic meter. This means it doesn't take much energy to accelerate the particles to very high speeds. Temperature is just a measure of the average kinetic energy per particle, so a little bit of energy leads to very high temperatures. That energy comes from shocks that develop as the material flows in the gravitational fields of surrounding clusters. And how do the particles stay hot? Well, again, it's the low density. As particles essentially never encounter each other, then they aren't bumping around, and that makes it hard to radiate away their heat. Dom X asks whether it's possible to tap into the zero-point energy or dark energy, like with the zero-point modules in Stargate. The answer is absolutely no. Vacuum energy can't be used as a power source. It's not just science fiction that abuses the vacuum this way. There's a lot of pseudoscience and outright scam science that claims this. In fact, it's worth doing an episode on the subject. Stay tuned. Faked Right asks if I'm the hobbit dude who hooked up with the hot elf chick. Dwarf, Faked Right, Killy the dwarf. Get it right.